So, your question about the, let's say, the separation of Singapore from this is an important one, and I think it's that kind of disjunct in our film history, right? So, when the lead film productions, I think it goes down around, was it 67, yeah, and then they moved, so there was Berlin Festivals, right? Yeah, and then P. Ramlee and all that moved. So I suppose a kind of center of gravity also shifted when it comes to film production in the Malay world. So that I think is very significant. So I think these films also, they record a moment in time. So the golden age, one sense that it's gonna be hard to replicate the golden age is this sense that the geography also has shifted, right? So the center of production has also moved upwards to KL. But that's not to say that, because like for example, if people are making made in Singapore movie musicals, I think these films would be such a wonderful source of inspiration. We see, for example, Royston Klein with his musicals like 881, but then his source of inspiration is actually Goliath musicals, right? Which is perfectly valid. I mean, that's his own cultural background. But if I suppose if you look at the history of Singapore cinema, there's so much that you can actually draw from as well.
Thank you. There's one point that I think is important for us to know. The assistant directors, the directors are Indian directors, but assistant directors are Malays. Yeah? Somehow, the director from my reading gave that kind of technical cinematic input. But when it comes to some cultural work, they refer to the assistant directors. So, it somehow mitigate that strong Indian repertoire, tropes, we call it. On the other hand, we can also see there's a kind of also a cultural affiliation between Malay culture and Indian culture too. Nothing strange, in terms of its common meaning, nothing which is, of course, when we see two things, A and B, but in terms of cultural life, it's not the case. Yeah? So it's important not to over-emphasize the difference. I think it's quite common when our cultural need, even cultural practices and certain similarities.
So I think that kind of idealization and visual influences, I think those things help us to rethink what we think are cultural essentialisms, right? We're pure, we don't want outside influences. I think it's impossible.
Actually, I have a question for Dr. Azhar. And I was just wondering, because you mentioned you read over 50 books.
Because, it's a fast reading. Yeah? It's not word by word reading. It's impossible to get into it.
And you mentioned that, your research, it was mostly looking at the ideational exchanges between the literati and film. But have you sort of come across possible connections between other different creative circles?
Especially if you relate it with the music industry, right? If you look at music composers, say Zubir Said, for example, and our migrant coming from Sumatra, working in Singapore, and then there's one Usman. Pak Usman, a few others, they were actually, there's always this interflow between, across the states of Malacca, and people coming to Singapore to bring their best ideas to sell them, and to be used as an expertise. Long before we call foreign talents, the foreign talents have already attracted the colony. So, this one music. Another one which I think quite subtle but it's quite hard to prove is actually the visual art. Yeah? It's quite interesting to look at those who design the studio sets. Right? Although it can be a template one, right? You can see some of the sets appear in many. But let's ask who created them. There must be some group, right? It's not just our knowledge exists. So there must be You know, if you look at the existence of Malay visual art groups APA, actually it's much earlier than I think ASAS can Google. Right? So it's very interesting. And if we look at again at the memoirs and their autobiographies, there's always a mention that they like to brew coffee, bersembang, a coffee shop, and then you know all this interaction in town, especially in this part of this area, they sit and then they interact. In fact, one of the memoirs that I read, they play from that regular meeting to do sports. Yeah, so quite a healthy interaction. You know, it's not like you know elite kind of superstar, you know, not mixing the local people. Yeah, so I think there's very organic, if I may say, very organic interactions. And I think that part of the organic interaction reflects very much the kind of cultural production we're doing.
Just sorry, Bangsawan, input from Bangsawan. It's more as popular. Before film movie watching, they want. I think some of the texts, there were scripts or some narratives of Zulu in all these Malay films, or the text actually originated from some.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, the early movie production pre-war, the actors come from the Bahdar, right? It is quite a natural transition from you know a stage theatre performance, Bahdar, full repertoire, and then to movie. That's where it's quite natural, and then slowly those. If I may add, around the same period, there are also Malay drama group. Yeah? I had to find the connection. If I can find the connection, it's quite interesting how theater group, right, which is outside the movie entertainment industry, I think that would be quite interesting to go with it. But nevertheless, within the same environment, yeah, I mean, kind of, you know, this part of the island, you know, actually not the entire island, but you know, pockets in the central and the eastern part of the island is the most concentrated by the population. I think the interaction is inevitable.
So my understanding is that because there was cinema and it sort of like sucked up all the talents, right? That you hardly had like parallel drama troupes, you know. So in a way, cinema came in and displaced Bangsawan as popular entertainment. Once cinema came, then Bangsawan declined, and of course later when TV came, then cinema declined. That seemed to be the narrative of these technologies coming in, disrupting, right? Yeah. So, but you're right. So, and there's so many funny anecdotes about Bangsawan people entering cinema. There was an actor who always played the Jin Afrit role in Bangsawan, and that's the big genie role, the villain. And he could not speak in a normal speaking voice. And then, you know, and on the sound set, they were telling him, hey, you have to go softer, but he's so used to projecting in a huge booming voice for the stage. So there was some kind of process of domestication before he could actually perform, yeah, for the camera.
Just another question.
Yeah.
And I think I guess with Alfian mentioning, you know, looking at this idea of the cinema history from the golden Malay, golden age of Malay cinema, and you know, question of cultural, you know, whose cultural heritage it is, and also democratizing these to make these films, you know, more accessible to everyone. But you mentioned that there was this. The time when it was made was a period of cultural revitalization, and also you know it was a time of political struggle. I'm wondering if in during that era there was a kind of tension, in the sense of, and also I think it came out a bit in the video clip that you showed. So this tension of you know making something for a Malay audience versus making something for a Singapore audience. So I was wondering if the both of you could comment on that.
By Blake again, South of 1955, Independence 57. There was a time where there's more demand that actually Malay should assume more greater position, yeah, in various sectors of the public, cultural, and governmental life. So it's quite natural that, you know, they demand that more Malay directors should be given a chance. Yeah. Movie companies, you know, Shaw, Katie, took Indian directors actually because of the experience. Mm. Right? They have record experience that they have delivered. Somehow, you know, I mean, in terms of being in a colonial setting, that the indigenous people are not able to deliver. I mean, that is part of the puzzle of ideology, isn't it? Right? That you think that, you know, it's not that you can't trust them, but maybe they cannot deliver. Right? You just put them as assistant directors. But that was quite long to be an assistant director. So there's a demand within the former union, actually, if I'm not mistaken. And then they would demand more, that more Malays should be in the directorship. It's quite interesting that the nationalist sentiment becomes now more racial tone, that more Malay representative is to be there. But I think along the way, as such as the process, if you look at, you know, just now, like this, the themes, yeah? It's a Chinese capital, Indian directorship, and Malay actors, right? That's very much Malay, right? But at the core of it, it's still very Malay, right? I mean, it's the medium is Malay, the repertoire is Malay, right? Let's ask, you know, based on numbers of audience, yeah? How much it attracted non-Malay speaking audience? The largest, they say, is only 30%. And even then, it was the kind of stories that attracted most, which is Pontianak. Right? Yeah. So, you know, all the people say it's Malay, blah, 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 right? But it's still Malay core, right? So, having a Chinese capitalist, having an Indian directorship, I think it has no less fervor of its Malay component. Right? I think that's something which is, maybe because we are used to compartmentalize things. That if it's Indian director, then it will be less Malay. And if it's owned by Chinese, it will be less Malay. Yeah? I think it doesn't work that simple. Right? I mean, if someone, investor, Chinese investor wants to sell nasi lemak, you think, hey, make it more Chinese, it's nasi lemak. You think they will? I don't think so, right? I mean, after all, nasi lemak is still nasi lemak. So, I mean, we have to stop, categorizing, basically. And I've seen this repeatedly made in commentaries about Malay movies. Right? As if that, you know, actually, we cannot live together. Yeah? It's like as if, you know, when you compartmentalize.
I do agree, large part, that you can characterize that, you know, most of them were Malay films in a sense. So there's, but also there's a big question of what then did we define by Malay, and I think all this were those discussions at that time. What kind of nationalism should we have? Is it going to be an ethno-nationalism that's based on the primacy of a certain race, or is it going to be civil nationalism, right? So where which is less racial. So the idea of what is Malayan, the idea of should national culture be based with Malayness as a core, if people are using Malay as a national language, can it be just a national language that's not so much related to, you don't have to carry the culture, but you can use it as language administration, etc., which is the discourse on civic nationalism, right? So I think as much like, so I think this is something to problematize, but, you know, can you feel a sense of connection to these films despite not being of a Malay background yourself? And I feel that there are filmmakers in Singapore who attempt that. So I see, for example, Seven Letters, you see Eric Koo in a kind of Valentine to the golden age of Malay cinema. So there's one segment in that, which is his kind of tribute. I don't think it's done very well, romanticized, and his recreation of the Pontianak movie is also a little bit stilted, you know. There's something I find problematic about, as much as he's trying to say, okay, there was a kind of innocent sense of horror in it, there was also that underlying idea that, oh, it's very primitive horror, because the Pontianak mask is, you know, very cheapskate looking. Yeah, they didn't have like special effect makeup at that time, right? Or very sophisticated ones. So I felt it was a bit problematic. But there's another filmmaker called Daniel Hui, who I really like. He's got a film called Snake Skin, and it references a lot of this material. And in fact, he really wants to get it out on DVD, etc. But he's stuck on trying to get rights for the song Tunggu Sekejap from Sajan Hasan. And I say, hey, can change, you know, because we really want to see a film, you know, but because it's like $20,000 for just to pay the rights. And I feel like so many more Singaporeans should watch this film, so it's sort of an idea at that. But for him, he's like, no, I have to have the B-Rundi version of Tunggu Sekejap. I refuse to have any covers or any other person doing it. It has to be that particular version. So obviously, he, as a filmmaker, finds this inspiring and useful resource in his own work.
To be fair, let's see. When Malays were involved in the movie production in the 1560s, are they really to be Malay in the first place? Right? Because, you know, if you look at Malay language, right? I mean, Malayan is an English word, but it never appeared in the Malay as Malayan, or a Malaya, it's Melayu or Sunganju. They're very ideas, but it's totally different by saying that being Melayu is ethno, totally. Because there's two types. One, the tribalist, right? Which is, you can trace the tribalist, let's say, Kajai, you know, which is very strongly ethno, as compared to what we call affirmative nationalism. The one that, you know, under colonialism, people just want to affirm their identity, right? Without denying other people's identity. Okay, that's, I think, quite fair. And in any colonialism, all indigenous people want to assert their very rights. That's very much. But you don't see playing that game. In fact, even though normally characters are very minimal, you don't see that tribalist position. Let's say today, the Malaysian movie today anti-Chinese rhetorics, right? Yeah. What's the last one by Suhani Babu, if I'm not mistaken? Anyone can remember the title? A Malaysian movie, it's quite controversial, right? So on the 19th. I mean, a certain slant, that kind of what we call tribalist nationalism, where your ethno group is the one that's supreme, that matters. But that kind of nationalism is the affirmative type. You assert your cultural affirmation, right? So I think it's quite important to see this something.
Most of these films from the modern age of Malay cinema, I think Professor Abdullah said, at its core it's actually Malay, but I think we can always find exceptions to this observation. In fact, what we're screening, two films, Serene Valanti and Saman Timoka Kasiku, especially Saman Timoka Kasiku, where in the film they talk about the promotion of interracial marriages. Yeah, and Serene Valanti, there was the script. The storyline is in fact written by a Chinese who's in fact working for the show, but his goes by the name of a troubling him. And I suspect that he was in fact wrote the storyline to Bujang Apuk, or maybe was using ideas from other films or other stories and changed it to Bujang Apuk. Because if you look at credits to Bujang Apuk, troubling him was credited as a Moderator writer. Yes. And also, I think in the early 50s, there was an attempt to actually promote this Malay language films to the larger community, and Malay was lingua franca as well, because we find advertisements of this Malay films in Chinese papers of the time, especially one that was published by the Shaw Brothers. It's called The Muslim. So they are not just advertisements, they were in fact synopsis, write-ups of the films, film stills. And every Malay film would have a Chinese title. It's usually a very poetic Chinese title. It's like, we call it Chinese words, so it's usually four characters, or three characters. And they can mean somewhat differently if taken literally from the Malay title. And I think this honest deserves to be mapped out. And I think it might suggest other ways of approaching this Malay language. So it's not just focusing on core, but the fridge, you know, what can be said about all these films and how they might have been exposed to a non-Malay speaking audience. Yeah, maybe, I think, because this is my observation, it's just the early 50s, and then towards the later half of the 50s, maybe the take up whether people Chinese or other non-Malay speaking population do not actually watch the films, other than the Pontian ones. Yeah. But there are always exceptions, okay? Because you find all this again in Malay films, they were advertised in Chinese movie periodicals that were published by Malay, and also this movie news. I mean, what's the title? Well, it's okay. There was, in this English movie periodical, Malay films were also advertised and publicized in this magazines.
I just want to add to us a little observation. So as much as we want to, we're talking about the kinds of so-called realities, historical, social realities that you're portraying in your cinema, right? And if it's overwhelmingly Malay, for example, is that a problem? What about cultural production for the other races and communities? But I just want to make this observation that there were a lot, the Chinese community, if they wanted to watch Chinese films, a lot of it was coming from Shanghai and Hong Kong. And of course, you know, there was a very well-developed Indian cinema industry as well. So there is this sense that Malay cinema was emerging to cover up its own space, you know, and stand alongside these other kinds of cinemas as well. Yeah.
I think it's time to open the questions to the floor. So running out of time. So I think we'll take maybe three questions at a time. So I think the mics are to the side. That's it. So just raise your hand and
make
a question.
Hi, my name is Swahili. Hello? Yeah, Swahili, my name is a curious director and all that. It's not a question about sharing. Today in Malaysia, you have this phenomenon of Malays going around in the traditional clothing and so forth and all that. In fact, the last pass in Ghana, the pass in Malaysia, you have the top leaders, which they've never done before, the Kriis, Tanja, and all that. Where did it start? It started here in Kampung Glam. There's a great shop there, and the guy wanted to just make it more interesting so people look at his characters. Why don't you people dress up? And subsequent years, they dress up and so forth. I was one of those few people. And it started in Singapore, a phenomenon. Singaporeans then came up at multiply.com, for instance, and we started to show people. And Malaysian Chris collectors saw this. And about 9 years back, 10 years back, 11 years back, they had a seminar in University of Malaya. They invited us. I was one of those people, and we went there. And we were the only one dressed, Singaporean Malays dressed in traditional busana. And it was after that the whole thing exploded. So now they want to buy a full set, full gear, and so forth. It's very easy. There are people who are in Facebook selling that for them. But at that time, we couldn't get any. Right? We will call people in Malaysia and say, is this, you know, Mr. So-and-so and so forth, can he make this, can he make that, can he make this? Then the fellow there will say yes. Well, we would like to make an order for like 10 pieces. Sorry, we just passed away. That kind of thing. No? But now this is not like that. But how did we actually come up with all this? Because there's nobody here in Singapore. We tried to get mandams, and mandams basically, it's just awful. So the only reference we had was the Malay movies and cinemas and so forth. And we saw how much about films and all that. And we actually looked and we really like that. For instance, for me, you know, all those videos and all that are pause and trying to draw it out and so forth. And then we'll show the tailors and mandals and all that, can you make this for us? you know. And it is from there that subsequently that you have all this development in Malaysia, to the extent that even us now, with their whatever we don't know, basically then in their retirement they started wearing all this, and all this started in Singapore, in this area. And of course the link is Malay cinema in the past, in the 50s and 60s, Hang Jebat, Hang Tuah and all that, you know, how they wore their clothing and all that. So I got my friends basically to say, let's go back to you know, the books and so forth as reference there. But in the beginning, when we did not have Malay cinemas and so forth, because I remember I talked to Chego, Mr. F, before, and he told me that yes, there were people in the categories and so forth who knew all these things, and they referenced all these things, you know, how to wear, how to fold, how to do this and so forth and all that. And if you realize, Malay movies nowadays, if they do show traditional clothing and so forth, you know, that there's a lot of BS out there. There's a lot of mistakes being made and so forth. Because really, you don't have people like Sharif Midan from the Bangsawan period and all that, tell them what to do. It is not all that bad, right? But yes, if you look from the 1950s and 60s, film and so forth, you know, that people like us doing creeds and so forth and all that, yes, the link is there. Basically influence the socio-political landscape of not here in Singapore but up there in Malaysia, because right now going around wearing full traditional gear and then you know he don't mind you with your craze and all that. Yes, unfortunately, you know, in that sense, all this daring to wear all this outside, the start was here and it was the time was with the influence of the past. That's all we should share. Thank you.
So I just wanted to ask whether can be films as a continuation or extension of the oral tradition versus the written form that was emphasized by colonial cultures during the period of colonization. Because if we were to link with the excellent Malay manuscripts exhibition that's going on in NLB right now, we know that even though we look at the manuscripts itself, they were actually enjoyed more in the oral, you know, they were listened to, right? So, can we then see films as a form of resistance or even going against colonial policy, hence making it conducive for things like alternative readings of Jebat, which we have in film form? Thank you.
Can we take another question? So just to collate the questions together. Okay.
Thank you for the talk. Actually, I was wondering, in the 50s and 60s, right, there was a lot of development in Indonesian cinema as well. Like there were films like Tiga Dada and Balochandran, which were pretty big in Indonesia. And the whole concept of Nusantara, and the whole Malay Peninsula as a whole, right? So I was just wondering what's the influence of Indonesian films on Malay films and vice versa, or if there was even any, or what about how it affected the discourse on Malay cinema as a whole?
Okay, thank you.
Do we need to repeat the questions? Okay.
Maybe I start with Suhani's comment. You're right that movie inspired certain kind of cultural imagination view and the facts referred to the so-called authentic. But remember, during that period of time, their cultural manifestation itself is seen as something that's still not pure. It's very modern. Right? So by today's standard, you see their films as, oh, this is authentic Malay culture. In all period of time, there's always this what we call cultural leveling down. Right? It happens. So they say Malay movies, suddenly, you know, the kind of traditional garb that they put on, right? Suddenly, oh my god, you know, all this come from Ma and Dal, from Juchat complex. Which is actually, you know, a vulgar piece. Yeah? But one possible inspiration, this may be my speculation, that inspired those two are actually from the royalty. Because normally the royalty's garb and so on, traditional costumes and so on, are understandable. right? If you look at the photos, 19th century, and even from description of the text, more or less, you know, they don't change much, you know? Right? So I think the royalty had that posture. You know? The second one, yeah, by Sadari, the colonial policy of Malay education is to promote a certain literature which is of respecting and subservient to the authority. Yeah? So Sejarah Melayu is the favorite text. If you read Sejarah Melayu, the main theme is be a subservient loyal subject. Likewise for Hikayat Hantua. Right? But when it comes to oral stories, these oral stories are not all being orally passing down from one mouth to another, but all stories that are already compiled in books form, short books. So they are used in Malay school. So we benefited both the high literature and so-called the oral literature. So if you look at the film subject of the titles, you can see actually both from the high court text and from the, for example, he kept Simiskate. So there's a story about Simiskate and something like that, you know, which is quite common, Kalila Damina and all those, which is, these are from the authors. So, my reading is that those who are involved in the producers and those who wrote the script are themselves Malay teachers, right? And then the educative part of it was quite strong. Right? It is not a consumption or just merely assertion of identity. There's always this mission to educate. And at that time, as I mentioned earlier, the strong anti-feudal attitude translates into the kind of dialogue. Right? In fact, almost all that I've seen, right, there was no ruler's glorification. Right? The ruler can be the center subject of the movie, but the plot and the story goes that actually the plural person, characters, actually the real ones, which is totally different from the text. Yeah, this is very important for us to look. I think that cultural interpretation. For your third question, this is, of course, the Indonesian movies, you know. But I would say, I have not seen web records, I think you know better, whether Indonesian movie were screened here. Right? Would you? Yeah. Was it very popular or is it many? Maybe you can answer later. But from my take is that Indonesian literature ideas, literary ideas actually more visible. Singapore and one, Malay teachers actually lack of books written in Malay. Have books needs to be imported from Balai Pustaka in Indonesia, in Batam. Right? So Balai Pustaka is a standard book used. For example, as early as Balai Pustaka in 1908, and then Pujangga Baru, which is a literary book, 1933. If you look at all the literatis, they consume Indonesian work. So, and also the traffic of Indonesian intelligentsia coming here. And a very active role, actually, of Indonesian consulate in Singapore. They have a cultural affairs department. For some reason or another, Indonesian have a very interest. What's happening in Malaysia, in Singapore and Malay? They have a cultural liaison. So they always interact with these people. I think that's part of this Indonesian agenda, Indonesian language, whatever it is. Yeah? So, the Indonesian influence beyond that, there is, but I think you can share more on the Indonesian.
Okay, I didn't track whether how Indonesian films are actually distributed or exhibited in Singapore, but I do know that Shaw Brothers in the 30s, they were actually distributing and exhibiting Indonesian made films in Singapore, and in fact they were even advertised as Malay films. And I think because of that, because they see the popularity of these Indonesian films, how they received in Singapore and Malaya, in their cinemas that they operated. So they started to want to make their own films, to make their own local produce Malay films. And other forms of connections, in the late 50s and early 60s, Barra Manado, one of the actresses, she formed a production company herself called Maria Manado Productions. But she often uses Cathy Perry's facilities, so it's a connection, but though she owned and produced the films. And she invited Usman Islam, so now the father of Indonesian cinema, over to Singapore to make films. So there was a collaboration between Maria Manado Productions and this organization called Puffy, which made When the Dawn Breaks or something. Yeah. And also this Rokoba Tina, which was in the first edition of Sierra Ocean. That was also directed by Usman Islam under a pseudonym called P.L. Kapoor. And also another observation, Nusantara Film Productions, which existed in the early 1950s, the directors, the names they adopted for themselves, so they are more Indonesian sounding. So for example, A.R. Tompel was in fact the first Malay who directed a film. He was using Amaya, A-R-M-A-Y-A. And then also another Chinese film director who directed Malay films, who goes by the name of Xu Jiaoming or Xu Chaoming. He actually used the pseudonym M. Vijaya. Okay, so it's very Chinese. And so they actually wish that all these productions would also enter the Indonesian market. But I think some of that didn't work out. There were some restrictions in terms of trade. So there was not really this exchange that really happened. And also during the confrontasi period. I mean, it's just my speculation. I think maybe films are made here and films are made there didn't come to us, or they were not distributed in Indonesia. Yeah, so, but this, yeah, I think this we can find more. Yeah.
And,
and so I think they were invited Indonesian actors and actresses to actually appear in the many films they were shot.
Just to add on, you know, sometimes this question of were there Indonesians, Malaysians, Singaporeans around that particular period, I find that we need to unpack that also, because you know Indonesia is a post-colonial construction, etc. Right? So, and actually you can trace Ibrahim to Aceh, you can trace Suresai all the way to his Minang, right? Siti Tanupera, strong Javanese accent. So the idea of the Nusantara is a lot more wider than I suppose that we think of today. As to talking about the decolonization of that, I think that's an interesting point about oral versus written division, whether cinema contributes to that. I think there's a bit of that when we try to mimic bits of dialogue. From Anakasim, from Ibu Mutuaku, for example, right? We do that. But I think there's a whole thing, you know, this whole cinema and decolonization. I would like to point out to writings about third cinema, in which we are talking about decolonizing the cinema, not just through the content, but also the form. If you look at certain things like Hollywood continuity, editing, and all that's coming from the West, how can we challenge those kinds of forms? So I suppose this goes more into like experimental cinema, I suppose. And maybe if you think about it, what about if I want to have a cinematic version of Bangsawan, for example? That might be one way to decolonize, right? So Bangsawan has got your story, and then all of a sudden you have one thing which is called an extra turn, where they change the set, where they, you know, close the curtains, change the set, and you can put anything in front of the curtains. You can dance the mambo, you can say, ladies and gentlemen, this is the latest hula dance from America, you can do that. So if you do a cinematic version, what the hell would that film look like? Right? It's a story, and all of a sudden, you know, you find something like completely unrelated, maybe that's one way in which you challenge the form.
Being a port and being a trade route and of course being
extremely excited, and I think it was directly impacting the way that Singaporeans or Malayans or however you want to call it were watching Malay film productions as well. So I think it's actually led to a direct decline at a time when the nations were separating, at a time when the people were leaving. So it was this perfect storm of the demise, so to speak, if you want to call it a revival. So my question is, we keep dancing around the topic of the Pontiana, but we never really go into it. So perhaps maybe I could just hear comments from all four of you, including the curator, on this ellipsis that we are experiencing with horror films. And I think the way we're looking at horror films today, a lot of it is coming up. I think almost all of it is coming up from Chinese productions, and we don't really question the kind of blatant racism and the monocultural, monoracial purity that Chinese horror films are trying to push to a Chinese-speaking audience. I don't think they're apologizing for that. I don't think that's a question of continuity there. I think there's a very clear break between Malay horror films in the 1950s, which contributed to the peak of the Golden Age, and what we're seeing now with Chinese horror films. So is there a comment, I think, that anyone found interesting?
Is there another question? Okay, here we go.
Hi everyone, my name is Izan. Thank you for such a wonderful and insightful discussion. I'm kind of curious to know, because we basically, when we think about the Malay film industry, we always think about the 50s, but we don't really remember much about movies in the 90s onwards. So I was just wondering, from your perspective, do you think we will ever see another period of a golden age of Malay cinema? If that's not the case, what are some of the challenges faced by the Malay film industry presently, and like maybe 20 years back, faced by the directors or like the industry in general? Like, what are some of the challenges they face towards achieving such a goal, like the ones in the 50s?
Thank you for that question. I thought it was just an awkward dose too. But I think that's a great question. Question to end on. But I also wanted to add on, I think, you know, with Azhar's presentation when he talked about the intellectual and cultural environment, I was wondering, it wasn't brought up, and I think it should maybe all three of you have something to add. But do you sense that there is a dismantling of that? That kind of environment and how that perhaps has impacted our
culture just one thing, just a little note about the Pontiana films. The early ones are all lost, right? The first one in 1957, I think that's lost. So the story is that Ho Aluk, who was holding on to them, disposed of them in some mining pool, etc. Because no one wanted to take them off him. People did not value films enough. And he was running out of storage space, he got to argue with his wife. Then, Mariam got married. That's right, to the Sultan. And then he forbade screening of the film. So for a very long time, he couldn't screen it, right? And there's no archive to donate that to, etc. So it was so frustrating to that movie. So I suppose that's one gap in how we are. Trying to rediscover those if they are missing and they're gone. Am I right?
Yeah.
A kind of historian.
He needs quite a lot of
other versions of Pontiana, like sequels and sequels. Yeah. But the original trilogy only one still exists.
So also I can't comment exactly on this idea of erasure and in horror films that made in Singapore. All I can say though is that in Malaysia, there's so many Pontiana films. at least for a time before there was some kind of weird crackdown, which was, this is promoting superstition, etc. But you do have like Pontiana, Sundal, and a few other Pontiana versions. So I suppose in Malaysia it's still doing that. So that's the interesting thing about splitting of cinematic history, right? So Malayan cinema became Singapore and Malaysia. The question about
I think about the golden generation.
the golden age, yes. So I think that to answer that question, I will just say that we will also not have a golden age of Hollywood. In the sense that a lot of these golden ages happened pre-television, pre-internet. Yeah. So there are different ways of spec leadership these days, I believe. And that's why, you know, because of technology, it's not just Malay cinema, it's just cinema in general.
Regarding the movies of Kuntiana, yeah, it's quite interesting why it was first launched or even produced. It's actually a marketing strategy of, I think, is it Catty or Shaw? Catty. Yeah. They need to pump up money. They know that to capitalize on Kuntiana, which is a common hantu in existence. If you live in this part of the world, it's impossible that you don't know Kuntiana because it's everywhere around the world. So, also in rural areas, blah blah blah, a common meme shared by Chinese neighbors, Malays, Indians, and so on. So, they capitalized on it and attracted a huge audience, right? But over the years, the kind of Kuntiana movies that we produce are of lesser quality, I would say, because of our expectations, yeah, of its makeup, so on and so forth. If you look at Thai cinematic techniques, improve a lot. You see, earlier Thai movies and present Thai movies, Thai movies, ghost stories are actually one of the fabulous in Asia. You know, you really feel that the ghost is beside you. But today, if you look at any Malay ghost movie, if you attend Malaysian cinemas, the audience laugh with you. Yeah? And they know when the Kuntiana or any other hantus will come. Right? So people making comments, you know, in the movie itself. Yeah? I mean, that's very interesting because people are just get tired of its. It's kind of a cliché cinematic trope. Coming back to, and of course that the multiracial part in Malay Kuntiana movies are actually, I would say, it's part and parcel of that flavor layer. For the golden age, whether coming back, I doubt so, because the expectation is very high today. We are more familiar with Hollywood, Bollywood, whatever wood. Yeah? Malay movies got a lot more to catch up. Even today, I think Indonesian movies catch up very fast than Malay counterparts. And I think on the one, I'm not to be pessimistic, less capital being pumped in. Maybe we have good actors and actresses, but one thing that lack is actually the software, meaning the cultural input, the cultural literacy. Yeah? Let's look at Putri Gunung Leda. Right? I think, well, it's good that you want to be creative, but historical interpolation, yeah, can be so bizarre, you know, that it doesn't make any sense. You know? I mean, even Hollywood produced many historical movies, but the departure is not so blatant, right? But here we have suddenly the dialogue is actually a dialogue which is typical urban KL type, you know, of a classical movie. You know? It doesn't, you know, in terms of its the clothes that they wear, you know, blah, blah. They try to capture the grandeur, but I think it lost in its cultural input. So the moment where the cultural input is not strong, you can never produce good. I give you one example. The Thai produce, I think, Langka Suka, right? Which is based on actually a Malay movie, actually a Malay historical myth. They use it, but in terms of its cinematic technique, I think they did a lot of homework. Somehow you feel like, hey, wow, and you know, from the details of it, you see they are very serious, but not putting good. It's very. There's one scene where Hunter said, "Dalam tuku." Come down, right? I think that's one of the most horrible dialogue ever. Yeah?
Maybe experiencing is maybe a different kind of village. This village deals with what we call a studio system. And I think the studio system can actually survive maybe with a democratization of means of production. So I think anyone can make a good film, and MM2 is coming up with its own means of production, almost like an integration of sorts. So that's been yet to be seen. And for the pointing up films, I don't think I've watched enough horror films in these days, but I think you can actually start to trace things back. For example, the kinds of Shaw Brothers horror films they were making, like The Oily Man, was that because they would have influence from around here? It was made by categories in the 60s, 50s, 60s. So, I'm not sure. But there was really a huge trend of Hong Kong production companies making Nanyang-themed horror films. So where the superstition and horror from visitors from Hong Kong experiencing that in Nanyang, the Southeast Asia. So there are many instances of that. And some of the Bomos or the faith healers still enacting those horror. Well, they're usually acted by Chinese, but you are not sure the story themselves what actual what racial makeup they are.
Well, I'm not too familiar with horror films either, but that sounds interesting to sort of compare contemporary Chinese horror films with those films that you mentioned. So we have run out of time. Thank you very much for
and find out more and hopefully see you back here. Thank you.